So no real disclosures. I am an inventor of an appendage closure technique, but I will not be talking about that today. We all love-hate warfarin. We like what it does. It's a pain to use, and most frustrating is the underuse that we experience. So many preventable strokes because of the fear, difficulty, and risks associated with warfarin. The difference between the novel agents and warfarin is the targeted sites where they work. Thrombin inhibitors like dabigatran and activated factor 10 inhibitors, site-specific, eventually preventing thrombus formation. The good news is that we have really good data on the use of these agents, and really some of them are no longer new. All of you probably have used at least 2, 3, or 4 of these agents. The good news also about them is that they work, and the two main things we fear with atrial fibrillation, ischemic stroke, systemic embolization, and intracranial hemorrhage. For stroke and systemic embolization, they are all equivalent, or in some instances, like dabigatran at 150 milligrams twice a day, better than what we see with warfarin in preventing these catastrophic strokes. Even bigger in terms of inducing fear in us is intracerebral hemorrhage. Even though it's an unusual cause to see it with warfarin, when it does happen, it's awful, with either mortality or devastating untreatable strokes that occur. Across the board, newer agents decrease the chance of intracerebral hemorrhage. There, it's an easy statement to make, and it's something that's not disputed with any of the agents. Gastrointestinal bleeding, however, is a different story. Some agents, such as higher dose dabigatran or rivaroxaban, do have more GI bleeding. So it's a bit of a mystery. How does this happen? It works just as well, but you have less specific intracranial hemorrhage. And it may have to do with the widespread nature of warfarin effects, specifically the effects on tissue factor and activation of factor 7, which may be site-specific in the cerebral cortex. So it gives us at least a theoretical construct for having the best of both worlds. Prevent embolic stroke, equivalent GI bleeding overall, but less intracranial hemorrhage. Comparing the agents, bottom line is they're very similar in terms of overall efficacy for ischemic stroke and preventing the major complications, the safety story with the newer agents. A few things, however, for practical use you have to keep in mind. You have to understand some pharmacokinetics, particularly issues of renal elimination. Dosing, once-a-day dosing with rivaroxaban and edoxaban. And we have to put specific scenarios, such as drug interactions or coming off an agent that gives us a flavor about one agent over another. Elderly patients, some agents are showing slightly increased risk, and the fact about being elderly that's most important here is renal function and renal clearance. So an example I'm giving here is with dabigatran. It has a large amount of its excretion is from the kidneys, and you can see especially with the area under the curve, a major increase when there is moderate renal dysfunction. How do we factor these in? Rule of thumb, if you have severe renal insufficiency, 15 less in creatinine clearance, we don't use the newer agents. The major trials excluded patients where renal clearance was less than 30, or in the case of apixaban, less than 25. Remember, dabigatran is predominantly renally excreted. Now, what you should take away in this very nice kind of summary recently published in the European Heart Journal is the 3A. That is, you can use it with careful adjustment except when renal function is severely impaired. There, even though we don't know safety data with warfarin, it is the drug you'll reach for in those patients. Now, one of the reasons we hated warfarin is we had to learn all this stuff about drug and food interactions. We're not off the hook with the newer agents. The new piece of information and player is PGP. So this glycoprotein P, can think of it as a resecreting transporter. You take a drug, absorb it, and it chucks it back out into a lumen, mostly the intestine and a little bit into the kidneys as well. All of the newer agents are affected by PGP. So other drugs which are PGP inhibitors will get rid of this resecretion and increase the drug levels of these agents. For example, you think about dabigatran. The efflux transporter, PGP, if it's blocked by an agent like verapamil, there's going to be an increased level. So new piece of information that we have to keep in mind when thinking about the NOACs. What does this translate into in practical use? Most of these patients will be on other heart rhythm medications, and the ones to remember are verapamil. Verapamil, you want to reduce the dosage of dabigatran as well as edoxaban, and a little rule of thumb is take it together. Take it at the same time. The kinetic profile is such that you tend to mitigate against swings in the drug concentration. Dronabinol is the other one to remember, lesser extent amiodarone. Word about transitioning, so you're already on warfarin and want to go with a newer agent. For rivaroxaban, you can do it as long as the INR is less than 3, less than 2 for other agents. One word of caution, the nice thing about the newer agents is you don't have to monitor them. The flip side is because they're not getting monitored, and it appears that if we were to monitor them, maybe we can predict better who still gets a thrombus or who gets bleeding risks, we may see in the years to come something more about monitoring. For now, the common tests that we do are of no value with the newer agents. They do get affected, the PT, PTT, but they don't do so in a linear fashion where you can predict the effect. For dabigatran, if you have a doubt if someone's taking it, you can do the ECT, not widely available, eccerin clotting time, but widely available is the dilute thrombin time, which will tell you if it's normal, they're not taking the dabigatran. Bleeding, if you're in a situation with bleeding, we know that there are antidotes for warfarin. If you want to do it quickly, we have fresh frozen plasma. It doesn't work with the newer agents. Because of the plasma abundance of these drugs, they will actually block the factors in fresh frozen plasma. Specific antidotes fast-tracked now, based on some excellent results in the study, is idarucizumab for dabigatran, likely will be used by most of us in specific situations. Remember, they're not dialyzable, and the antidotes we're used to using do not work with the newer agents. I will give you just a couple of final comments. Where do we still think about warfarin? Remember, for mechanical valves, if there's already a thrombus or moderate mitral stenosis or worse, rheumatic mitral disease, it's still going to be warfarin. If compliance is an issue, then you're better off with warfarin because it's easier to follow, and drug effect, drug costs as well. Everyone is a potential candidate for a newer agent. Just be cautious with the renal clearance issue. Make sure you know how to calculate creatinine clearance and have some kind of quick guide for newer drug interactions in these patients. I'll stop there and thank you for your attention.